I'm gonna make it plain. In 1877, America, the greatest country on this planet, put laws in place called the Jim Crow laws. And the Jim Crow laws restricted the rights to quadroons, octoroons, blacks, Hispanics, Indians, Malays, restricted medical, restricted relationships, restricted education, restricted life. It told us that we were less than, and it came on the heels of the 13th Amendment. It came on the heels of 55 individuals, great Americans, writing the greatest document called the Constitution of the United States, saying, "We the people." Now, the reason why those destructive laws came into place, I think, can be greatly described by Martin Luther King. And what he said about time is, he said, "I'm not ready to wait 100 or 200 years for things to change. That I think actually that time is neutral. That it can either be used constructively or destructively. That human progress rarely rolls in on inevitability. It is through human dedication and effort that we move forward. And that when we don't work, what happens is that time actually becomes an ally to the primitive forces of social stagnation. And the guardians of the status quo are in their oxygen tanks, keeping the old order alive. And so the time needs to be helped by every single moment doing right." And the reason why these Jim Crow laws were in place that stifled my rights and your rights is because we fell asleep. We fall asleep when we're moving ahead and we don't look to the left and right and see that we're not including people in this move ahead. Because really, at the end of the day, we only move forward when it doesn't cost us anything. But I'm here today saying that no one and nothing can be great unless it costs you something. One out of every five women will be sexually assaulted and raped before she reaches the age of 18. One out of six boys. If you are a woman of color and you are raped before you reach the age of 18, then you are 66% more likely to be sexually assaulted again. 70% of girls who are sex trafficked are girls of color. They are coming out of the foster care system. They are coming out of poverty. It is a billion-dollar industry. When they go into the sex trafficking business, and they call it a business, trust me, more than likely, they are gang raped. I am speaking today, not just for the Me Toos, because I was a Me Too. But when I raise my hand, I am aware of all the women who are still in silence. images in our media that gives them a sense of self-worth enough to break their silence that's rooted in the shame of assault, that's rooted in the stigma of assault. Written on the Statue of Liberty is come. Come, you tireless, poor, yearning to breathe free. To breathe free. Every single day, your job as an American citizen is not just to fight for your rights. It's to fight for the right of every individual that is taking a breath, whose heart is open and breathing on this earth. And like the originators of the Me Toos, the Fannie Lou Hamers, the Recy Taylors, who in 1944 was gang raped by six white men, and she spoke up. Rosa Parks fought for her rights. She was silenced. To the Tarana Burks, to the originators, the first women to speak out, it cost them something. Nothing and no one can be great without a cost. Listen, I am always introduced as an award-winning actor, but my testimony is one of poverty. My testimony is one of being sexually assaulted and very much seeing a childhood that was robbed from me. And I know that every single day when I think of that, I know that the trauma of those events are still with me today. And that's what drives me into the voting booth. That's what allows me to listen to the women who are still in silence. That's what allows me even to become a citizen on this planet, is the fact that we are here to connect. That we are here as 324 million people living on this earth to know that every day that we breathe and we live, that we've got to bring up everyone with us. I stand in solidarity with all women who raised their hands because I know that it was not easy. And my hope for the future, my hope, and I do hope, that we never go back. That's not just about clapping your hands and screaming and shouting every time someone says something that sounds good. It's about keeping it rolling once you go home.
That's right. Keep it rolling. Keep it rolling.
And it's now my pleasure to introduce a leader with a long record of fighting for women's equality and for the rights and dignity of all people. Mayor Eric Garcetti. Responsibility for making sure that women's leadership at City Hall has grown in historic numbers since he took office. That's why he's the only mayor in LA history without any all-male commissions. And the first to achieve gender parity on those key appointments. That's an incredible record for the moment we're in. but let me share quickly just how ahead of the curve he's been. Now, a lot of the men have been wearing Time's Up pins on the red carpet lately. But he was an undergrad when he led the National Student Coalition Against Harassment, when he challenged more men to help take back the night. He worked in Ethiopia as a young man specifically to advance women's health and empowerment in Africa. And he has long been a force against human trafficking, a tragedy and crime that affects women across the globe. Please welcome Eric Garcetti!